Remember that, and then we have a very special time we're going to have on November the 1st, the first Sunday in November, November the 1st. We're going to be having a Sunday school teacher. If you are a Bible study, a Bible study leader, or you want to have Bible studies maybe in your home or here at the church, please, we're going to have a training just for that to help you be able to lead through that. So if you all, that's going to be for everybody who is planning on doing any kind of teaching Sunday school or Bible study, small group leaders. We're going to have that right after church on November the 1st. So there'll be a meal that is there, and we need to know how many to prepare for. So you can sign up also on the Welcome Center or on the app. So please do that so we'll know how many is coming. And so thank you for that. And it's time that we lead other people. If you're going to have a small group of 2 people or 10 people or 15 people, how many it's going to be, want to help you with that. I want to know how we're going to do that as a church. So please remember that and ask the Lord's blessing on it and ask His will to be done. I want to ask you to stand together all over the building as we prepare to pray. And trust the Lord this morning. The Bible lets us know that we can lean on Him. We can trust in Him for all things this morning. And we want to give God praise. This month is our breast cancer awareness. We're also praying for a lot of others that have cancer. So thank you for those that have turned in names that we are praying for and trusting God to work in their lives and give them encouragement, give them strength during this hour. And most of all, to pray for healing. How many of you know that our God is a healer? Would you say amen? And I'm glad we can trust in the Lord this morning. Please pray for Faye Alton, who is in Winston. So please remember her in prayer and under life support. So please remember her, that God will lift her up. Pray for James Taylor as he has surgery tomorrow. So remember him in prayer. Also continue to pray for Adam Waters from healing from surgery this week. Pray for Ashlyn Borders, who was in an accident on Friday evening. So please pray for her. And if you'd like to donate to help her with medical expenses, you can do that on our Facebook page. So please just go in there. There's a link you can click to help with those. So please remember her in prayer. Just a miracle. The Lord touched her life. So please continue to pray for her. And then I know there's a lot of COVID cases that are happening all around in our county and across our state and throughout our country. So please remember all those in prayer. And remember Brother Jerry Curtis. Please pray for him, that God will touch him. His mother passed away, and that receiving will be tomorrow beginning at 1:30 till 3 o'clock, and then the funeral will be at 3 o'clock, and that's going to be at the Miracle Church in Lenore. So please remember the family in prayer, that God just encourage them and speak to them, and the Lord lift them up. I'm glad this morning to know that no matter where we are, no matter what kind of burden we have, no matter what kind of prayer needs we have, that God is able. Amen. Would you just, this morning, listen, here's what the Bible says. This is found in Luke chapter 1 and verse number 37. It's the place where the angel comes to Mary, and he said, I want to let you know this is what is going to happen. And she looks at that angel and says, I just want you to know something. It's not physically possible for me to have a baby because I have not known a man. Here's what he told her. He said, I want to let you know, with man, it is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. How many of you believe today that He's able? Amen. We want to give God praise that we can trust in Him, lean on Him. And as we pray this morning, let's remember our country in prayer and remember our communities in prayer. So I want to ask you this morning, what is that one thing that you need specifically in your life? That thing that God has speaking to you about, that thing that is a burden in your heart. Listen, whatever it may be, I want to tell you, God is able. Maybe there's a person this morning that you're praying for and you're wondering, God, is there any hope for this person? Is there any hope for this situation? Can I just let you know, there's hope today, amen? And we can trust in the Lord. Let's pray together as they come and prepare to lead us in worship. Let's pray together. Father, we love you this morning and thank you for the word of God. Lord, your word gives us faith to believe and trust and know, God, that there's absolutely nothing that you cannot do. Father, you know what you are saying to us this morning. God, you know why you have allowed us, God, to be able to live another day. God, why you have purpose for us to be here this morning to worship together, to honor you together, Lord, to praise you together, Lord, to lift up your name together, God, and to come and to seek your face. Father, we pray for every single need in this building. God, every need in our parking lot, God, everyone that is sitting on the porch this morning, God, that you're speaking to, Lord, those listening by radio, those who are watching live and joining together this morning in worship, we come before you to say yes, God. Lord, we come before you, God, to realize and understand, Lord, if there's not one thing that we have on our heart today that you cannot answer, you are a miracle working God, and we want to praise you, want to worship you, God, for the prayers you've answered, the miracles you've done in our lives together. Father, we just want to praise you, God, today for that person that we're praying for. God, that nothing is impossible with you. God, I pray right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you would open their eyes, open their heart, open their understanding to the word. God, that this morning, Lord, their lives, they'll come alive to you, Jesus. Lord, they'll see that you are the Savior. God, they'll understand, Lord, that you are the one who is able. Father, as we pray this morning, God, we're praying together this month, Lord, for those who are going through cancer treatments. God, we pray for healing. We pray for strength. God, we pray for your blessing and grace, God, to be upon them. Father, we pray for Brother Jerry Curtis. You would encourage him and lift him up today. God, bless his family, Lord, as they prepare, God, tomorrow for this service. Lord, bless them. God, thank you for his mother who knew you and trusted you and that you carried safely home. Father, I pray, God, this morning, Lord, that you would just touch every single need, God, that's been mentioned. Lord, we want to praise you for just touching Ashland Borders. Lord, answering prayer, God, in their lives. Lord, we want to give you glory. And God, we ask you for complete healing of her body. God, that you would touch her. You would lift her up. God, I pray, Lord, right now, Lord, over her life, Lord, that you would just bless her and lift her up. God, just meet every need they have. Father, we pray for Adam. You continue to minister healing to him. And God, in James tomorrow, as he goes for this surgery, Lord, you would just lift him up and encourage him. Father, there's so many today. I'm glad, God, that we can believe and trust and know, God, that there's absolutely nothing that you cannot do. God, we're living in a country that needs you. And God, as a church today, we just come together, God, asking you to intervene. And God, send a spiritual awakening, God, upon our land, upon our families, upon our friends, God, upon our lives. We come this morning to say yes, Lord. And God, we just ask you, Father, oh God, that you be lifted up in this place. God, we're here to honor you today, God. Lord, we're here to praise you today, Jesus. God, we're here to give you glory, God, for your salvation, your love. Oh God, I want to thank you for your long-suffering. God, thank you for the peace that you give us as your children. Father, we just ask you right now, God, to bless every need and exalt the name of Jesus. God, we're here, Lord, to lift you up. Hide us behind the cross. God, I pray this morning we would pour out our heart before you. I pray, God, you would bind anything and everything that Satan may try to put in the way that would keep us from hearing you. Oh, God, I pray, Lord, that you would honor your name in this place for your glory. And we give you thanksgiving in Jesus' wonderful and holy name we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. How many of you know that at Calvary, lives are changed? How many of you know that whatever you have and wherever you go, that if you get it to the cross, Jesus is able? Amen. Let's worship him together in song. Hallelujah.
Jesus, I spit in vanity and pride. Not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died at Calvary. By God's word at last my sin I learned, then I trembled at the law I'd spurned.
Y'all sing with us.
Till my guilty soul imploring turned to Calvary. There your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me. There my burden sold my liberty at Calvary. Now I give to Jesus every. My raptured soul can only sing a of Calvary. There your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. There your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. Salvation's plan. Oh, the grace that brought it down to man. Oh, the mighty gulf that God did span at Calvary. There your mercy and your grace was free. There your pardon multiplied to me. Was free, there your pardon multiplied to me. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary. There my burden so found liberty at Calvary.
Ain't you glad for Calvary this morning? Y'all may be seated unless you want to stand and worship with us. It's up to you. He's worthy this morning. Some people think you're distant, just some words on a page, that you're nothing more than fables handed down along the way. But I've seen you part the waters when no one else could pull me from the deep. That's who you are to me.
Some people think you justly in cathedrals made of stone, but I know you live inside my heart. I know that it's your home. And I've seen you in a sunset in the eyes of a stranger on the street. That's who you are to me.
You're amazing, faithful, love's open door. When I'm empty, you fill me, hunger for more of your mercy, your goodness. Lord, you're the air that I breathe. That's who you are to me. Who you are.
Sometimes I have my doubts, I'm sure that everybody does. And I wonder when I stumble, am I still worthy of His love?
And I know that I get stronger when I'm talking to you down on my knees.
You're everything I need.
You're amazing, faithful, love's open door.
touch him this morning. He is worthy.
I want to say something. I don't know if you, those of you that are in Bible college, but we've been singing about what we've been learning about is drawing up close to him. And when you feel like you're alone or that you need something, girls, I'm talking to my Bible study group, I guess, get in his lap. Get in his lap and just curl up and let him feel you, because nobody else can feel that void. Nobody. I just thank God.
If he's been good to you, let him know this morning. Amen. He's worthy this morning.
I've been looking back along this winding road to the old familiar markers of his mercies I have known. I know it may sound simple, but it's more than I can explain. There's no other words to tell you than to say
God's been good. Times by my side, he's always stood through it all. God's been good.
Looking back, and I can see I've cried some bitter tears, but I felt his arms around me as I face my darkest fears. See, I've had more gains and losses, and I've known more joy than hurt, as his grace fell down upon me undeserved.
God's been good in my life. I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams as I go. I've had my share of hard times, by my side he's always stood through it all. God's been good,
for God has been my Father, my Savior and my friend. His love is my beginning, and his love will be my end. I could spend
He's worthy this morning to be praised.
But the best way that I can say is this:
God's been good in my life. I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams as I go to sleep each night. Though I've had share of hard times, by my side he's always stood through it all. God's been good, God's been good in my life. I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams as I go to sleep each night. Though I've had my share of hard times, by my side he's always stood through it all.
How many of you believe God's been good? Amen. Hallelujah. I praise the Lord. You can be seated. It is great this morning to know that we serve a God who is always able, and I praise him for his ability, his power, his grace, and the mercy that God gives us. And we want to give him praise today for all that God has done. If you're watching today live, let us know that God's been good to you. Amen. Give us an amen, a praise the Lord, or he's just been good to me, and I praise him. Give God thanksgiving this morning. I want to ask you, are you excited about Jesus coming again? How many of you know he's coming again? Amen. I praise the Lord that we can trust in him and lean on him and know that we serve a God today who is always faithful. Every step you take in life, if you know Jesus, every step you take draws you closer to the coming of Jesus. He is coming again. And friend, if you don't know him, I want to remind you about something. Every single breath you take in is a drop of mercy from God himself, and given us an opportunity to know him, to trust him, and to be saved and come out of that place in our life of giving our heart to him. And so we look at God's word and we understand something about the day that we're living in. Unless you have your eyes closed, your ears closed, and your heart hardened, you are seeing that Jesus, how exactly what he said in his word would come to pass before he comes. He is coming. Amen. And we want to praise God this morning for the hope the Lord gives us. Today, I just want to, what if he came today? Are you ready for Jesus to come? Amen. He's coming, and we want to give God praise that he's coming again. I want you to take your Bibles and turn to James. We're going to look at James chapter number 5 this morning, and Lord willing, we're going to conclude this series about faith works. Not only that faith does work, but faith has to have works with it. If you don't have faith, a faith that works and faith that has something that changed your life, friend, the Bible says, he said, we don't have real faith. Real faith changes us. Real faith challenges us. Real faith convicts us. Real faith comforts us. And we watch in the word as James just simply picks apart every part of our life and says, are you a believer? I want to thank him this morning for his wonderful word. Amen. Now, we have the doors open, so if you get a little cool in the back, we have a lot of room up front. Amen. So you can move on down this way if you get too cool. But we want to praise God for the opportunity just to meet together and worship. Amen. I've watched people, and I think about as Americans and the American church, how we have come to the place that we love our comforts. Amen. I watch some of our missionary friends in other countries, and they come in the middle of their rainy season and stand in about knee-deep or waist-high water just to worship. Amen. Amen. Friend, I want to tell you, James had that kind of faith. James said we ought to have a faith that don't stop us. Or to have a faith that we just don't lay down and say, well, it's just not comfortable today, and it's just not one of these things that I'm going to do today. We are in the place of, as our lives are in 2020, you better have faith in Jesus. He's coming, amen. And so we look at the word of God that is relevant for every situation you'll ever be in is the word. There may be, you look at the word and you say, wow, that was written and compiled, and God put all of that together so many years ago, and it has been preserved for us today. And while we look at it, we say, yes, they were going through that then. But I want to tell you something about my God. He makes his word alive right where you are, amen, and right where I am. And so as James is speaking to us, and we read the word, you need to understand that God is speaking to us today. The word of God comes alive. Here's what faith is. We've looked at it. Faith, all through the Bible, this word faith is used in the same way. And it means this. It is a reliance upon Christ in salvation. It is believing and knowing what God has said in His Word, that I take that to heart. I believe Him. I trust Him. And I go with what God said. I'm relying everything I have upon what God said. How many today, you remember when you trusted Jesus as your personal Savior? Would you say amen? I want to ask you something about that time. What did you trust in? Did you trust in the fact that you prayed a prayer? Did we trust in the fact that we made a move or had an experience? Or do we know that we go by the Word and I did what God said in His Word? That's where our assurance comes from. So faith is trust in the Word of God. And when you trust in the Word of God, it produces a work of the Holy Spirit. And so we're understanding from James. He said, I want to let you know, if you have faith, you're going to have works that match the faith that you have. And so as a believer today, we look at the Word and say, God, what are you saying? How are you bringing that to pass in my life? Faith without works is what? It is dead. And so James reminds us of that many times. And in James chapter 2 and verse number 26, he said, faith without works is dead. Now, can I ask y'all a question? This is an English question. Is the word is that something that is present, that is going on right now? He said, so I want to ask you a question personally about your faith, not from yesterday, not from last week, not from all the things that are, but right now, is your faith having works that match the Scripture? Here's what happens in our life. We love in our world to live in the past in our memories. Y'all know what I mean? I remember my grandpa, we were sitting on the porch. I can go back to the place where we were sitting and sit on that same porch. And it was in one of those metal gliders. Y'all remember them whenever you was growing up. And that thing would squeak, and we were sitting in it. And now, back then, you could pick them up on the side of the road. People just pitch them out. Now them things are worth a lot of money, amen? We were sitting in that thing, and he said, I just want to let you know something. Boy, I sure did like them were the good old days. He would start telling about the good old days. He would start talking about all the things that happened in those good old days. But then he would say, those are good memories, but I sure do like to go in. At the time, they had pull light switches in the house. You know, the string that hung down that hits you when you run through the living room. Can I have a witness right there? Amen. He said, but I'll tell you what, I sure do like to go in and turn the light on. So sometimes as Christians, we want to live in our memories of what God did back here. But James said, I want you to know that the faith you have back there is the faith you're to have today. And it should produce works in your life that will glorify God and will bless you and grow you as a believer. And so we're watching how that happened all through the book of James. So how the steps to know true faith with works is this. He said it. He said, we need to get our faith straight. What is the difference between faith and works? Can you have faith without works? Can you have faith without works? He said, I want you to get it straight. You can't, that's in chapter number 2. He said, you cannot have a faith. You can say you have faith, but if it don't have works, it is not the same. A faith in Christ works has supernatural and spiritual work in your life. And then he said, we're going forward. We're going to step into that faith and believe you. How you come to chapter 1, he said, we're going to grow that faith. In chapter 2, we understood they were giving it all. Abraham, Rahab, they gave everything. Just because you sacrifice something does not mean you have faith. It is when you have faith in God and walk in obedience, how we watch your life change. He said you can have good fruits in your life. From James chapter number 3, he said when you have faith, how you'll have works that will produce good fruits. And then we look at last Sunday, that he giveth more grace. I want us to look at something because what James does in chapter number 5, what chapter? Chapter number 5 is this, is he brings us to the place of seeing how we take all of this faith and works and then we apply it in our lives. Because he says this in chapter number 1. He said, I want to let you know something. He said, if you're going to be a hearer of the word only, you deceive yourself. He said, you have to be a what of the word? A doer of the word. He said, you got to have the word in your life, not only hearing it, understanding it, but walking in it, living in it, and loving God through it. So I want you to look with me, if you will, to verse number 7. Look there with me in verse number 7 of James chapter number 5. The Bible says in verse number 7, be patient, therefore. It's time for an altar call. Y'all ready? He calls us to be patient. He said, be patient, therefore. He said, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Unto what? How many of you believe he's coming? He said, I want you to know something. I want you to understand that everything you're living for and living in is for the coming of Jesus. He's coming. Oh, and then he says in verse number 7, he says it like this. He said, behold, the husband waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth and hath long patience for it until he receive the early and latter rain. But look again in verse number 8. He said, be ye also what? Patient. He said, don't go to the place that you understand, that you just let everything go. Trust in God. And here's what he said about that. Establish your hearts. And then he reminds them again, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. What if today you knew Jesus was coming at 5 o'clock? Could you wait that long? Could we say, wow, he's coming today at 5 o'clock? So that thing that I just prayed for, hallelujah, either way, I'm a winner. Can I let you know, if you knew how that Jesus was coming tomorrow, could you be patient and say, wow, what I'm going through, I can wait. I know he's coming tomorrow. And Jesus, you're going to relieve me. You're going to deliver me out of where I am. When you look at James, here's what James says about where we are in James 5 and verse number 7 and verse number 8. He said, I want you to know something. We're to have an anticipation of Jesus coming. It's not that we just understand, wow, Jesus is coming, but to be grounded in faith and realize every step I take, he could come. We're to live like he is coming today. Amen. And we're to prepare in grounded faith like we are going to live and see all of these people that we've been praying for get saved and God change their life. And so he said, in faith, you have a ground, you have a foundation of your anticipation. It is not just something you're saying, wow, I hope Jesus comes today. No, I have faith. I know at every step I take that he's coming. And today I could take a step and the next step could be in glory. Amen. He is coming. And James said, here's what we're living for. This is what your faith is for. This is what your work is for. Because Jesus is coming. Hallelujah. How many of you believe he's coming? Amen. He said, I want you to know he is coming. Jesus living in anticipation of the coming of the Lord. Jesus is coming. And faith looks forward with works that witness that we're ready for Jesus to come. He's coming, amen. Here's what he said. I want you to go back with me to verse number 1. Because he reminds us in the middle, verse number 5 and verse number 7 and verse number 8, why we are living, what we have faith in. We have faith in Jesus, amen? And we have faith that he's coming. We have faith in his word. And then he said, I want you to understand where our world is. When you read verse number 1 down through verse number 6, you understand something that is happening. It is a picture of 2020. He said, I want to let you know something that is taking place. And he said, verse number 1 says, I want you to go to now, you rich men, weep and howl, for your misery shall come upon you. So what is he doing as we read in the scripture? He's talking about the coming of the Lord. He said, I want to let you know something. Not everybody is going. He said, I want you to know not everybody is going to be in heaven.
Not everybody is going to go in the rapture or the coming of the Lord. Not everyone who dies and puts a suit on in a, and has a suit on his body or her body that has a dress on it in a casket is in heaven. He said, I want you to know there's those who are living and they are going to be lost and they are going to be in hell. Not because that they had money or didn't have money, but because they did not know Jesus and have faith with works. He said, I want you to look at your life and see what is going on. America is one of the richest countries in the world as far as all of the population. Did you know today, right now in our world, that the biggest part of the population of the world does not have a meal to eat this morning? How many of you at least have access to food? If you do, would you say amen? But he said, I want to let you know something. Those riches can cloud your heart. They can cloud your life. Those things that you have can be put in the way between you and God. And he says in these verses of scripture, look in verse number 2. He said, your riches are corrupt. He says also, and your garments are moth-eaten. And so he begins to speak to us. And he said, I want to let you know something. In those riches that you are trusting in, there is corruption that happens. I've been in them. I've been with people when they passed away. I have seen a lot of funerals, and we've been involved in a lot of funerals. But I've never seen anyone that took everything they had and put it down in the grave or in the casket with them because they were taking it with them. But I have seen a lot of stuff rust in my life. I have seen a lot of stuff fall apart in my life. I have seen a lot of things in life that has corruption. So the wealthy and abounding that trust in the riches, they find that there is, the Bible says, weeping and howling that is taking place in their lives. And there's miseries that has come upon them. Did you know today in the United States of America, our suicide rate is higher than it has ever been? In the state of California alone, in 1 month, they had more suicides than they usually have in the whole year. Friend, can I tell you what is happening? Everything that people have trusted in our life, it has become corrupt. And we have no basis. We have no foundation. We're not grounded in anything. And we're just searching here and there. And all of our stuff that is around our life is filled with corruption because it is of this earth. The Bible says it like this in 1 Timothy 6 and verse number 9. Rich fall into temptation and a snare and into foolish and hurtful lusts which have drawn men into destruction and into perdition. He said, I want to let you know there's those who put their things in front of their life and relationship with God, and it's causing them to be destroyed in their heart, but it's taking them to an awful place called hell. Did y'all know that hell is real? And as much as Jesus is coming, as great as heaven is to know that there's a Savior in heaven and that our loved ones that know Jesus have gone to heaven, oh, I want to say hallelujah, amen. But I do know this, there's also, as real as Jesus in heaven is, hell is real. The lake of fire is real. The white throne judgment is real, where every person will give an account of their life before God. He said, I want to let you know those things you have trusted in, they've become corrupt. They have become moth-eaten. That little word corrupt means to perish. It means to be putrefying. It means to rot or to destroy. The word moth-eaten simply means that what you have has holes in it like a moth-eaten garment. And the Bible speaks of that over in the book of Haggai chapter 1 and verse number 6. He said, you sow to yourself, but you reap nothing. You have you drink, but you have no satisfying of your thirst. You have food, but it never satisfies you. And he says also in that word, he said, you earn wages, but it's like you are putting it in a bag with holes. So I want to ask you this morning, what are you trusting in? He said also in verse number 3, he said it's cankered. That little word cankered means like a cancer that is eating it away. It means a rust is what cankered means. I mean, here's what Jesus said. Y'all ready for what Jesus said about it? Y'all ready for what Jesus said? He said it like this in Matthew 6 and verse number 19. He said, I want you to know, lay not up for yourselves treasures up on earth. We are so earthly that we can't think about heaven. When I was growing up, I used to hear people say, oh, they're so heavenly minded, they're no earthly good. Friend, can I tell you, that went out a long time ago. We are so earthly minded that we're no heavenly good in this day. Oh, and he said, I want you to know something. Jesus said, don't lay up for yourselves treasures upon earth where moth and rust doth corrupt, where thieves can break through and steal. He said, I want you to know something, that don't heap up things that have no spiritual value, no eternal value with God in your life. And then he said, here's what happens. They make men cry. He said, that bondage that is placed upon them is going to cause those to weep. How? Keeping others living in bondage and oppressing others. We're living in a day, friend, when our world is oppressing those who do not have. Can I be real honest with y'all? Y'all really ready for this? And it's going to get worse. We're reading, we're understanding, we're watching how these things come to pass. And God said, I want you to know, it is going to come to pass. He said, they are out and they're laboring and they are doing all they're doing. And those who are rich, those who are over them, how they're giving it all to them and they're keeping them oppressed. There is a cry that is coming forth. Listen, just like the children of Israel, as the Hebrews were in Egypt, how they cried out, God, deliver us from this bondage. Friend, I want to tell you, our world today is filled with bondage. Oh, but there's an answer. Hallelujah. Oh, his name is Jesus. And James said, I want you to know, I want you to see what is going on. He says in verse number 5 and verse number 6, he said, you are condemned. He said, your riches and all that you are doing has condemned you. And it is causing you to be in that place of emptiness. You're living in pleasure. Did you know that living in the pleasure of sin will leave you empty forever? The Bible says it like this. Y'all ready for what Moses said? He said, I'd rather suffer with the affliction of the people of God, the righteous, those who know God, than to live in the pleasure of sin for a season. Can I tell you what happens in the pleasures of sin? Those seasons are short-lived. And destruction comes because those seasons in our lives when we're walking in sin are ruined and wrecked and ruled by Satan himself. And here's what he came for: to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So can I let you in on a little something in this day and hour? When you and I are trying to figure out life, when you and I are doing what we need to do, we're trying to make it through our life and make decisions, friend, make them on the Word of God. The Bible says here that they're living a condemned life, and when they have a condemned life, they want others to have a condemned life. And he said these rich, those who are trusting in this world and the things of this world, they have given themselves to the pleasures of life without preparation for eternity. Then listen to verse number 6. Look at it with me. Bible says in verse number 6, he said, as you watch their lives, he said, ye have condemned and killed the just. Who is James talking about? What is James talking about when he comes out of verse number 6? He said, I want you to know who you have sinned against. You have sinned against Jesus. You have put him to death. Your sins have put him on a cross. Friend, can I tell you something this morning? Listen, if you don't know Jesus, I want you to know something. It is your sin that put him on the cross. It was the arm of these Roman soldiers that whipped and ripped his back and his flesh off of his body. But it was your sin. It was my sin. Oh, that took Jesus to the cross and said, we are greater. Our sin is greater. We love our sin more than we love you. And here's what James said. He said, I want you to know you are condemned because you have condemned the just man. But I love what he says. I want you to look at it with me in verse number 6. He said, and he doth not resist you. You say, I don't have a clue about my relationship with God. I've lived in the riches of sin and the ungodliness of my life and after my sinful nature. Can I just let you know something today? According to Romans chapter 5 and verse number 9, in that while you are yet sinners, Christ died for you. Hey, I want to let you know how James could talk about the anticipation that he had, because he had been in verse number 6 as a condemned man ready to die, undeserving of the mercy of God and headed for hell. But Jesus came by. Amen. Hey, can I ask you a question? Do you remember when Jesus came by? Oh, I want to tell you, if you'll come to him, he will not resist you. Here's what the Bible says. He said there was rich men, but he said, I want you to know something. The Redeemer's coming. This morning, I just want you to say, Jesus is coming. James said, I want to tell you about your faith. You should recognize Jesus is coming. And everything you do is about Jesus coming. Living with anticipation. Oh, glory to God, I'm glad that Jesus is coming. We're to be excited Jesus is coming this morning, amen. I wish he'd come right now. Wouldn't it be good if Jesus just come right now, amen. Oh, some of y'all would be shocked. Because he'd have to wake you up to take you out of here. Amen. He said, I want you to know. James said, be patient. Jesus is coming. We don't live today without hope. We don't live today as those who are miserable without any hope. As a believer today, Jesus is coming. He is coming to take us home to be with him. Oh, here, I love what he says in verse number 7. He said, I want you to do something. Be patient. Understand that Jesus is coming in his time, not your time. Jesus is coming, as the word says, as a thief in the night. He is coming. Oh, that word patient, it simply means don't lose sight that Jesus is coming. Don't get covered up with all that the world has and all the things that are happening and forget that Jesus is coming. Every single thing that God said in his word would happen before the Lord's return has happened. You say, what in the world is he waiting on? I want to give you a little hint. Y'all ready? He's given us mercy and grace and said, I just want you to know, I'm giving you another opportunity to come to me. And for a child of God, he's given us another opportunity of what he talked about in chapter number 4, where he said, I want you to know I will give you more grace. And so be patient that the Lord, he is coming. Oh, and as he's coming, we understand that word patience, it means to be long-suffering. It means to be forbearing. It means to endure. Can I tell you a little something about James as he spoke this word in verse number 7? He said to be patient. What did he say to be? Did y'all know that the word patient is the same that we have over in Galatians chapter 5 and verse 22 and 23 when Paul said that patience, having patience in your life, is from the Holy Spirit. So what's James saying in verse number 7? He said, I want to tell you what, if you have faith, you already have patience, because the Holy Spirit lives inside of you. Now, I want to be real honest with y'all, can I? I've seen some of y'all at a stoplight. I've seen some of us, and we are like, man, this don't work out like we thought it would. Where's our patience? When the flesh is in control, we don't think about patience. When the Holy Spirit is living in our life and he is in control, we understand we are grounded with anticipation. Wow, before this stop, before I can try to push this person out of the way at the stoplight, Jesus could come. Amen. Listen, before this happens in my life and before it all goes, Jesus could come. He said, be patient, therefore. Understand that everything you do is about Jesus, and it's about him coming, and live for him and lift him up. It is showing your faith that is at work in your life by the Holy Spirit living in our life. Oh, he said, I want you to know something. He said, don't give up. Jesus coming. Just keep your eyes on him. Oh, you say, yeah, but you don't know how bad this is. I know. Keep your eyes on Jesus. We don't know how this is going to, no, but keep your eyes on Jesus.
Oh, he said, because those riches of the world, those things of the world, keep us from being who we need to be with God, and keep our patience to live for him, share him. Oh, he says it there in verse number 7. He said, I want you to know, be patient unto the brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. But I want you to look in verse number 7 again and understand something of why Jesus is coming. How many ever in this place, you've ever planted a garden before? Would you say amen? If you didn't plant a garden, maybe you planted one tomato plant. And I've seen people put a tomato plant in a bucket and it grow 10 foot high with tomatoes big around as your arm. Amen. You've planted something that you are going to get fruit from. If you ever done that, would you say amen? You know what God did? James says why Jesus is coming is because he planted a precious fruit. Now you're wondering why that person acts the way they do and fruity right beside them, because they fruit. Amen. He said, I want you to know what God did in your life. God planted precious fruit. He put it in. He is the vine. We are the branches. And he said, I want you to know something, that Jesus is coming. He is sending God, the husband of the vine, is sending Christ to come as the one, the laborer in the field, to gather the harvest and gather, the Bible says in verse number 7, look at it, to gather the precious fruit home. Why is Jesus coming? Why is Jesus coming? He's coming to take his children home. He said in verse number 7, he said, I want you to know something. Behold, the husband waiteth for the precious fruit of the earth. Did you know that God is waiting on you to get home? Hey, he says it like this in the book of Psalm 116. He said it like this, precious in the eyes of the Lord are the death of his saints. I want to tell you something. God is waiting upon you. If you know Jesus as your Savior, you are born again, but he's waiting on you to get home. Oh, what a day that's going to be. Amen. He said, you are the precious fruit. That word precious fruit, it means to establish, as he says, as he looks at it. It's an established fruit. We're not home yet, friend. I can tell you something. We're not home yet. How many of you right now, if you could escape 2020, would mash the button and escape it, would you raise your hand? Praise the Lord. Can I let you in on something? We might. Today, Jesus says, be ye therefore ready. For in such an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh. What if he looks at that vine and the branches and all of his children, that precious fruit, and says, today is reaping day. Today I'm going to pluck this fruit and bring it to the house. You ever thought about someone that passes away in the Lord? God had made them ready. They had trusted Jesus, personal Lord and Savior, and he just brought them home because they are his precious fruit. They are his child. And he said that is what Jesus coming is about. And because that you know Jesus, he's going to come and take you home one day. Oh, what a day that is going to be. Amen. And whenever I think about going home last night, we were riding in the car, and Adrian looked at me and he said, you know something? He said, do you think that Paw is talking to Moses? Amen. I said, you know something? I ain't got a clue. I can guarantee you this, he's talking, amen. But I thought, I don't know if he's talking to Moses, but man, what a thought. Glory to God that in heaven, whenever you're with Jesus and all the saints, all the precious fruit of God. Oh, what a day that's going to be. Amen. Oh, that precious fruit. And God said, I want you to know why I'm coming. I'm coming because his fruit is in your life. The Bible says it like this, that whenever you trust in Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes in your life. He seals you until that day of redemption, until he takes you home. He said he is the earnest, that is the earnest of God. And I want to tell you, he is going to fulfill his price. He is going to fulfill what he's paid for. And he is going to bring us home safe with him. But listen what he said in verse number 8. He said, I want you to be patient with passion. Look in verse number 8. The Bible says it like this. Be ye also patient. Can I ask y'all something? Who is James talking to? Believers or non-believers? believers, why in the world did he have to keep telling us to be patient? Maybe James is thinking about one of the disciples by the name of Peter. Man, Peter was not a patient guy. He'd whip out a sword, cut somebody's ear off, not even blink an eye. Peter was, he was not patient at all. He would just, I mean, it was just like, Lord, I'll never deny you. And the Lord said, oh yeah, by the way, you should have waited for what you said. How many of you know we'd be a whole lot better off if we'd be patient with our word sometimes, amen? He said, be ye therefore patient. Then in verse number 8, he said, establish your heart. Get your heart grounded. Know who you believe. Know why you believe him. Know who that you're trusting in to come and take you home. And know why he is going to take you home. Listen, he said, don't be shaken from the foundation of the hope that is in you. You say, yeah, but this person believes this. This person says this. Get in the word and let the word establish our heart that Jesus is coming. That word establish that he said, it means to confirm. It means to be steadfast. It means to set your heart. It also means to strengthen your heart. Have a passion for who God is. I want to tell you something. There's only one way to strengthen your heart as a believer. It is the Word of God. You say, I've got doubt in my life. Get in the Word. You say, I've got fear in my life. Get in the Word. You say, I have anxiety in my life. Get in the Word. Does that mean it's never going to come back? No, but every time you get in the Word. Get in the Word of God. He said, you have a passion for the Word. He said, be patient because Jesus is coming. Here's what Job said. How many of you know that Job, his whole life was wrecked? Would you say amen? He lost everything at one time. But you know what Job said in Job 19 and verse number 25? I know my Redeemer lives, and I'm going to see him. So what did he do? He was grounded in anticipation. He walked with anticipation that I'm going to see Jesus. I'm going to see the Lord. I'm going to know him. I'm going to walk with him every single day. I know my Redeemer lives. The passion is that Jesus is coming. When that person cuts you off in traffic, just remember Jesus is coming. When you and I face things that we would never want to face or never choose to face, just remember while you are walking through it that Jesus is coming. You say, yeah, but I don't like what is happening in my life. Yeah, but Jesus is coming. Live with a passion that Jesus is coming. Oh, we're to just look up every single day. Just remember Jesus is coming. He's coming, amen. I want to tell you today, Jesus is coming. Somebody just say, Jesus is coming. He's coming. Our Redeemer is coming. He's going to come save us. I want to give you what he did. Because after he talks about Jesus coming, James just takes our faith that Jesus is coming and he plugs us into life and says, here's how you handle life. Here's the remedy for life. He said, number one, in our life, from verse number 9 down through verse number 16, he said, you're to have compassion. How many of you believe that that a person of faith ought to be compassionate? Amen. It does not mean that you do not live in truth. It does not mean that you agree with sin. It does not mean that you look at somebody and say, well, I just put up with it, and I think it's okay, and it's going to be all right with God. No, if the Word of God says it's sin, friend. Amen. But we're to have sin and understand sin and know in people's lives when there's sin, and we're to have compassion upon them because they are blind. I want to ask you a question. If you saw someone today that was blind, and somehow or another they're standing in the middle of 321, would you help them get to safety? A couple of you would anyhow, hallelujah. Rest of you, impatient people want to blow the horn, amen. They're out in the middle of 321. They don't know where to go. I had a friend who was blind, Don Whaley. He did not drive a car. Y'all believe that? He depended on somebody to take him everywhere. Whenever you talk to him, if you could just hear him speak, you would think that Don could see.
I mean, like he was singing one day in church, and he said, "Oh yeah, on the way here, we saw a Jeep. Man, that thing was turned upside down. The wheels." I'm thinking, I can picture. How can he picture? He'd never seen any of that stuff. But here's what would happen in his life. He would get somebody to take him everywhere that he went. They would pull up to a church, sit him out in the parking lot, and drive off. It wasn't somebody that stayed with him. He'd get a ride. They'd pull up wherever he's going. You know what he would do when he got in that parking lot? He'd just stand there. Now, there'd be people walk by and look at him. He wasn't moving. You know why? He couldn't see where he was going. Somebody finally go out and get Don. He'd stand there until somebody come. He was not moving because he didn't know where he was. Can I let you know something about somebody living in sin? They have no idea where they are. The Bible said they are blind. The Bible said they are deaf. And the Bible lets us know they have a hard heart. They cannot move toward God. That's why, as a believer, James says, you show up in your faith with compassion. He said, grudge not, judge not, is what he says. Now, I want to tell you, I want to give you a little bit of a lesson this morning. Y'all ready? Get your pen and paper out, however you're going to write this down, text it to yourself, whatever you need to do. When you are helping somebody see their sin, that is not judging them. He didn't say, don't tell somebody the truth. He said, don't judge somebody like that you are better than they are. Amen? He said, you're to deal with them with compassion because God has had mercy and compassion upon you. And so he watched as he said, I want you to know from verse number 9 down through verse number 12. He said, listen, don't grudge them. Y'all know what the word grudge means? It simply means this. It is real simple. It means to be in straits. But the word grudge means to murmur. James said, if you have faith, you shouldn't be murmuring. He said, if you have faith in your life, that you should not. That word also means to grieve. It means to find fault. How many people you know today that say they know Jesus and they find fault with every single thing coming and going? Anybody? If you know of anybody else like that, would you say amen? Don't judge them. Just help them. Amen. He said, I want to let you know something. That grudge. That word grudge also means to complain. So James is saying, check your heart. Understand that in life, man, people are messed up. Our world is messed up. He said, you got to handle it with compassion, with a pure heart and a pure motive. Oh, I want to tell you, he will not fail. He said, have compassion upon them like Jesus has compassion. He said, here's the remedy. And then he says, I want to tell you what, there's a cure. Did you know there's a cure this morning? Do you know there's a cure for every single thing? I remember growing up, they would talk about some kind of roots and plants and some other stuff that they would mix up that would help you. Y'all from the country? Y'all know what I mean, don't you? I really, whenever I used to be at my granny's house, you did not want to get a stomachache at my granny's house. She'd give you a hatchet and told you which tree, yellow root tree, to go down to that was beside the chicken lot, the third tree over. You scraped the bark off and then you got the meat out of the tree. You bought it on the stove and you drunk it. Now, I'm just going to be real honest with y'all. I did it one time. That was enough. If my stomach hurt whenever I was at my granny's house, I didn't tell nobody, amen. Had that cure. Well, James said, I want to let you know something. There's a cure for everything. Hey, what did he say could be cured? Look at it with me in verse number 13. The Bible says in verse number 13, God gives. He said, is any among you afflicted? He said, if you've got affliction in your life, he said, here's the cure. Let him pray. What's the key to affliction and getting affliction out of your life? What's the key?
Pray. He said, I want you to pray. Then he says in verse number 13, he says, is any merry among you? He said, is there anybody that just, you're about to pop inside because you're so excited? He said, just let him sing psalms. Let him praise God. Then he says in verse number 14, he said, is any sick among you? Now, this is what God said. He said, I want to let you, anybody know anybody that's sick? God gives us a cure before we ever go looking for another remedy. Look at verse number 13. He said, like verse number 14. He said, let him call for the elders of the church. This is in the Bible just exactly like, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord, you shall be saved. Amen. He said, let him call for the elders of the church. He said, let them pray over him. So what's the cure? Prayer. Pray over him. The Bible said, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. Wow. God said, I want to tell you, if there's sickness, he said, here's the remedy, here's the cure. I'm giving it to you in the word. And then he said, and the prayer of faith shall save the what? Save the what? Sick. He said, I want to tell you how you first handle everything that is happening in your life. He said, and the Lord shall raise him up. What's God going to do? Raise him up. The Lord said it. He said, if any have committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. And then he said, I want to tell you how to fix your heart. Confess your faults. He said, get rid of what is on you. He said, and pray one for another that you may be healed. So he said, there's a spiritual healing and there is a physical healing. I'll tell you what, God's able. I don't know if you know this or not, but God's still the same God that wrote this book. He's still the same God that touched those who are dead. He's still the same God that said, reach forth your hand. He's still the same God that said, open the eyes of the blind. He's still the same. He can still save. He can still cure. He is our remedy today. Amen. You afflicted today with a burden? He said, pray. He said, if you got a merry heart, he said, just sing. Let the glory of the Lord shine forth out of your mouth. He said, if you in your life have sickness, he said, there is a cure. God said it. Amen. God said it, and then he said it this way. He said, do it this way. I want you to look in the latter part of chapter number five. He said, I want to let you know something. He said, you know what faith is? You know what works is? He said, it's time for you to have a righteous path in your life. That path that will lead you where you need to go. And he said it like this. I want you to back up with me to the latter part of verse number 16. He said, the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man does what? Availeth much. And then, so here's what he said. Elisha was a man subject to like passions as we are. Just look towards somebody, look at them right quick, and then turn back and look up this way and understand something. We are not ever going to go through anything that the people in the Bible did not go through. Said Elijah was just like we are. Yet, it says in verse number 17, it said, I want you to know something about him. He prayed earnestly that it might not rain. I want to tell you a little something about this story. The Bible says in the book of 1 Kings, chapter number 17, where Elijah goes before King Ahab, and he said, I want to let you know something, King, it's not going to rain. That's all he says. He said, it's not going to rain. God says it's going to rain, and he turns around and he walks off. You say, how in the world did he know that? Because the Bible says that Elijah had prayed for it not to rain. Wow. Do you think Elijah had faith in the God that he had prayed to? He said, it ain't going to rain. So we understand something about a righteous path. It is filled with prayer. It is an anticipation that is grounded in faith and believing what God can do. And the Bible says, and then in verse number 17, he said, it rained not by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And then in verse number 18, and he prayed again. So what is the foundation that is keeping our eyes on Jesus and keeping us walking a righteous path? It is when we pray. How many of you believe that God answers prayer? Amen. I want to give you this as we close. The Bible says that he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. God brought fruitfulness through prayer. James said you can take everything that we have looked at in these five chapters and you plug it in. This is how you're looking at the cord and saying, how do I get power in my life? How do I get my faith in my life? He said, I want you to do this. I want you to take it in verse number 17 down to verse number 20. He said, I want you to take what you know by the word and plug it into your life and begin to do it. Don't just be a hearer and say, yep, I know I need to do that. He said, be a doer of the word. Look, in the last two verses of scripture, in verse number 19 and verse number 20, the Bible said, brethren, if any of you do err from the truth. Can I ask you something? Have you ever erred from the truth? Have you ever walked away or backed away or backslid away from what God said in his word? He just said, if you have, and if you know someone that is, he said, here's what you need to do in verse number 19. He said, and one, convert him. That means you take somebody and you understand where they are and you lead them back to where they need to be with God. And he says in verse number 20, he said, let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the error of his ways shall has saved and shall save a soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins. God said, here's your practice. Here's how you walk a righteous path. It is prayer, and it's in that place that you and I, we practice the faith that God gives us. It is a faith that is working. It is a faith that is believing. It is a faith that is trusting God right where we are. It's that place that we understand that we're to make disciples. He said, you see someone err, go take them the truth. Take them the word. Get them in the word and practice what God has given in his word. You know where we are? We're at the place where we're to be grounded as a foundation with anticipation. When we pray for somebody, we're to be anticipating that the rain's going to start or it's going to stop. Whenever we're praying, we need to understand that God is greater than what we're praying for. He's able, amen. Now, I want to tell you this morning, Jesus is coming. Ready or not, Jesus is coming. Did you know you can live with anticipation every day that Jesus is coming? I'm going to ask him to come and get ready for a place of invitation in our life. I want to ask you personally this morning. In your life right now, as we've been looking in the Word of God, amen? I want to tell you everything that we have looked at has come from his Word. I want to ask you something about his Word. Does your faith look like the Word? Is what God says in his word what is showing in your life? As we look at the word, is it saying, yes, I believe and I know Jesus, and if he came today, I'm ready to meet him? Or am I looking and I'm missing so many pieces out of my life that I understand I don't have faith in Jesus? And if he came today, I would be left behind. I want you to do me a favor right quick. I just want you to look around where you are. If you're in your car, look over to the car beside of you. If you're on the, wherever, just I want you just to look around right now and see there's people. The Bible says it like this. He said there's going to be two in the field. One's going to be taken, the other left. He is saying some are ready and some's not. I want to ask you, are you ready? If Jesus came right now, do you know that you know that you know that you know Jesus? You say, well, preacher, I'm a teenager. It don't matter if you're a teenager. It don't matter if you're a young child. If you understand that you need Jesus in your life and that if he came today, that you are lost, that you've never trusted him, that your sins are keeping you from God, can I just let you know something? You would die and go to an awful place called hell. There's a Savior, praise God, who wants to give you life. Amen. And I want to tell you this morning, he's given us life for a purpose so we can give it to others as we go toward eternal life forever. Let's stand together this morning with heads bowed and eyes closed for just a minute. You say this morning, Pastor, while we are here right now, if I left today, if Jesus came today, or if I died today, right now in my life, there's people that I love that's going to be left behind. You know what the Bible says about us? He said it's time for us to walk a righteous path and to realize that we can pray. We can believe God. We can see God do great miracles. You say, I need to come pray for that person. It may be a spouse. It might be a friend. It may be a co-worker. There's somebody in your life today. Listen, that if Jesus came, they would be left behind. It might be a friend of yours. Listen, there may be an acquaintance. It may be somebody that somewhere in time you can go back to. Listen, you had a squabble with it. You had a fight with it. Whatever it is. Hey, I'll tell you, nothing, absolutely nothing, is as important as that person knowing Jesus. He said the effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man. That righteous man means that you and I are right with God, and we can pray. We can believe God. You say this morning, there's people in my life that if Jesus came today, they'd be left behind. Be grounded enough in your anticipation to realize, glory to God, I'm going. Jesus, I want you to save them. Help me to be a light to them. You say this morning, Pastor, in my life right now, as I look at these scriptures, I understand something about myself. And that is that I have erred from truth. I've erred from my way. I'm not being a witness like I need to be. I'm not praying like I know that I should, like God is speaking to me about. My patience in my life. Those things that God said should be in my life, I've laid aside. Can I just let you know something? God said if we'll confess it to Him, and He's faithful and just to forgive us of those sins. And God wants to cleanse us from all unrighteousness and make us right with Him. You said this morning, Pastor, I know today I should be excited about Jesus coming. But you know something? It just ain't in me anymore. I've lost hope. I've lost faith. Can I tell you, let Him restore. You say this morning, Pastor, I need to come right where you are. You may just need to bow where you are and say, God, I need you to, God, I need you to refresh my life. I need you, God, to restore me, Lord, and my faith in you. You say this morning, Pastor, if Jesus came today, I'd be left behind. Can I let you know something? As the Bible says in James chapter 1, or chapter 5, verse number 1, down through verse number 6. He said there's people that are trusting in what they have. They're trusting in things in this world. Listen, you can trust in a church membership and still die lost and go to hell. You can trust today. Listen, that, wow, one day I did this or one day I did that. James said, just put all that aside for a minute and look at your life right this minute. Does it say that I have faith? Because the works that I have, because what is going on in my life is together in my life. And I'm watching, as James said, this is what a Christian should look like, and that's what my life looks like. Friend, I want to ask you today, are you missing Jesus in your life? Do you know Him personally as your Savior? Say this morning, I know Jesus. Listen, if you have that assurance this morning, would you just lift your hand to the Lord? God, I know you, and I have that assurance. And Lord, I'm looking for you to come. I just want to praise you today. I know that I know I'm saved. Hallelujah. Would you just honor the Lord today? Just give Him a hand of praise. You say this morning, Pastor, thank you. Hallelujah. You say this morning, Pastor, I'm really not sure if I died today that heaven will be my home. I'm not sure that I'm saved. I'm not sure that I know Jesus today. Pray for me. Would you just slip your hand up? You may be a teenager today and God is speaking to you for the first time in your life about knowing Jesus. You may be a child God is speaking to for the first time that I don't know Jesus. Listen, you may be today as a young person, as a young couple, as a senior adult. I don't know who you may be today as God speaks to you, but I'm really not sure that I know Jesus. Pray for me. Would you just slip your hand up? I'm really not sure I'm saved today. Friend, I want to tell you, glory to God, Jesus loves you. He wants you to come to Him and trust in Him. You can step out. We'll take God's word, show you what God said, how God said to be saved. While these are praying, I want to tell you, friend, we serve a God who knows what you need. Will you join us and pray together? Father, we love you this morning. Thank you for the word of God. Father, I pray with those today that could not lift their hand in this place this morning. God, maybe they're watching online, out in the parking, or wherever they may be, but they don't have that assurance today that they know you. God, above everything else that is going on in our life right this minute, that is going on in our world right this minute, God, I pray for them to know you. God, and confess, Jesus, I'm a sinner. Jesus, I know that I've sinned against you. And I believe you died for me on a cross. I believe you, Jesus, that you not only died for me, but on the third day you arose. And today, Jesus, I ask you to forgive my sin. Come in my life, Lord. I give my life to you. I believe your word. I trust what you said in your word. God, you said, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And God, right now, by the authority of your word, I ask you to forgive me and come in my life. God, I want to pray with those today. Father, as we look at James, God, we know there's a place we can go back to in our life that we trusted you as Savior and Lord. But right now, in this place, right at this very time, God, we've walked away. We're not alive to you like we used to be. God, we're not living with anticipation that you're coming again. Father, I pray, God, that you would forgive us and help us, God, to realize that everywhere we go, everything we do, Lord, we're looking for you to come. God, I pray, Lord, that we would walk in you, live in you, serve you, be faithful to you, God, to see you lifted up and into our lives. Father, I pray, God, right now you'd restore us, revive us, oh God, refresh our heart in you, God. Breathe upon us, oh God, as your people, a spiritual awakening. Father, I want to pray right now, God, for every person in this building, God, for every person, our family, our friends, God, that don't know you. Lord, you've given us the opportunity today, God, to have hope, to have faith, Lord, to be able, God, to know that you are alive and well, that you are the Savior of the world. Jesus, I pray, God, you would save them. God, we pray, Lord, you would take the blinders off their eyes. God, you would lift the deafness from their ears spiritually, Lord, that they can hear you. God, you would remove the walls and the strongholds, God, and the bars they placed around their heart as keeping them from receiving your word. God, help us to be a light to them. God, help us, Lord, to shine your love, God, because we have a faith that works, that they can know you and be born again and be saved. God, I pray right now in the name of Jesus, we commit ourselves to live for you, to lift you up, and to glorify your name until we see your face. Help us to live for you and honor you, God, in everything we do. Lord, we love you and praise you. God, we give you thanksgiving this morning for answering prayer. With heads bowed, eyes closed for just a second, while we're just in the presence of the Lord, just say today, Pastor, I ask Jesus to come into my life. I ask him to save me today. Would you just slip your hand up? We want to rejoice with you. Hallelujah. God bless your hearts. Hallelujah, friend. God loves you. I'm glad we can trust in him. You say this morning, Pastor, as a Christian. Well, I've been kind of lazy as a Christian. Been kind of backed off as a Christian. But today I've asked God to help me, to restore me, help me to live for him and lift him up, that God would restore my anticipation that he's coming. I want to rejoice today what God's doing in my life. Would you just slip your hand up? Well, I've asked God to help me today. Restore my life. Hallelujah. Restore my hope. Say this morning, Pastor, I prayed for somebody. I'm believing God to save them and work in their life. Would you just lift your hand as a testimony of faith? I'm believing God to save them. Hallelujah. God, we praise you. We worship you. Lord, we yield to you, God, and ask that your will to be done in all of our lives. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. God is so good. Amen. I praise him, worship him. Guess what? Jesus is coming. He could come before you get to the stop sign. Amen. He could come before you get down to the stoplight. He could come before your next mortgage payment's due. Jesus is coming. Amen. And I want to tell you, we're to live every day that we're walking, looking for his coming. Today is your first day here at Poovey's Chapel. We want to say thank you for being here this morning. We have a very special gift for you at our Welcome Center right after service. And keep in tune with all that is going on with our social media. We try to keep everybody up to date. If we have any kind of changes that are going on with service.